Welcome back, everyone. This is Future PhD, Dr. E, and this is another episode of Putting the U Back into Graduate School. And today, we're going to talk about how to prepare for a graduate school visit and how to choose an advisor. So, let's get into it. Before we get into it, this episode is primarily for interested PhD students. However, if you are an interested master's student who wants to have a research experience, jump to How to Choose the Advisor segment to learn more. And with that, let's really get into it. So if you've done it, you've put massive efforts into researching schools and programs, spent hours studying for tests, stressed over writing your essays, turned in your applications, and dreaded over the decisions. You look at your emails, and you find the magic letter. Congratulations, you've been accepted to the graduate school. But wait a moment, you say to yourself as you look into the letter. What is this funding package? And what is this welcome visit? And today, we're going to talk about that right now. So let's talk about the money first. I'm going to start with master's because I have a lot more to say to PhD students. Now that you're in, you want to look at the programs that your school can reduce the tuition and or give you a stipend. Some schools allow master's students to TA class, and there may be university jobs exclusive to grad students. I suggest these methods because while you can find a job part-time in the city you live in, hours at the university are probably more flexible with your schedule. So let's talk about funding packages. Last time I said PhD programs are fully funded, so that means you get tuition paid for on top of stipends. However, not all stipends are equal. Some schools have a lot of money, so they use it to pay their students with large stipends. On the other hand, some schools don't have so much and they can't pay their students. For me, I'm a graduate student at University of Michigan and I make around 30K a year. Which may not sound like a lot, but Michigan is pretty affordable at 30K a year. I do have some buddies that make 25K a year at the UC system, and I have another buddy who makes 40K at MIT. So the stipend can vary. Around 30K is considered average though, but you want to consider the cost of living too. You aren't in grad school to make money, but you want to survive, and you want to make sure that the school you attend allows you to survive. Grad school is stressful enough, and you don't want to add bad finances on top of that. You also want to check the terms of your funding package. Like I mentioned in my first video, not all PhD programs are fully funded for 5 years. Personally though, I wouldn't consider a program that doesn't have a full 5 years of funding. To me, if a school isn't willing to secure full 5 years of funding, then they aren't a school that believes in you, and you don't want to go to a school that doesn't believe in you. So all right, now that that's out of the way, let's go to the next part of the video, the visit weekend. At the bottom of your letter, you probably got an invitation to visit the school at a certain date, and if you got multiple letters, you probably noticed that the dates are probably somewhere between February and March, starting on Thursday, and on a Sunday, and more than likely, if you have few invitations, they're happening at the same time. If you did, congratulations! This is the welcome weekend, and I suggest you go. Why? Because first, they're free and you get a lot of free stuff. Second, they're fun. Third, this is the best time to get to know your future cohort. And more importantly, this is the best time to get to know your future advisors. That said, you probably should limit your visit to 4 visits top. And I say this because the first welcome visit is amazing, the second is great, the third is good, but once you get past 3 or 4, they start to become a chore. After all, you're traveling a lot in a short amount of time, and you don't have much free time at this point. And while I think you should approach each visit with an open mind, you don't want to have too many options. So again, you should visit the top 4 schools you're interested after they accepted you. But what do you do if the 2 schools you want to visit have conflicting schedules? First, don't panic. This is intentional. Grad schools make it this way so students are forced to choose. My recommendation? Go to the school you really want to visit and ask if the other school has an alternative welcome weekend or if they're willing to host you for a private visit. If the school says no, then great. The decision's made for you. If the school's not willing to do this, that means they don't believe in you. And again, you don't want to go to a school that doesn't believe in you. Okay, so I've rambled way longer than I thought I would. So let's get into the next part of the segment, how to prepare for a welcome visit. So the first questions you want to ask yourself are the following. Who am I and what do I want? I know. These are very basic questions, but work with me here. You only have 3, maybe 4 days to get all the information you need to make a life-changing decision like grad school. So you want, no, you need to be intentional. Oftentimes, people are dissatisfied with their path in grad school because they weren't intentional enough in these questions. This has happened to me a few times too, and I don't want them to happen to you. But back to the questions. So, when I say who am I, you want to know what kind of person you are. For example, do you need a personal connection with your boss to do your best? Do you explicitly need instructions, or do you thrive in ambiguity? Are you quiet and prefer to be alone, or do you need a group setting? These questions are something you need to ask because those questions will lead you to what you want. For example, I'm a type of worker who needs to know what the project is and there's restrictions as well as a deadline. As long as I get to work on the project how and how I want and when I want to. And I want to work in a lab that allowed me to have an advisor that didn't micromanage. And voila, I found one. You may be different, so what you may want may be different, but here are some sample questions you should ask yourself about who you are and what you want. I'm gonna be real with you. So for these weekends, you are royalty. These schools are fighting for you to attend, not the other way around. You should know that and you should definitely enjoy it. And if a school is making it seem like they're doing a favor to you to attend, that's not the school for you. And sorry, I really didn't have a good place to put that, but I just wanted to tell you right now. So let's get to the breakdown. So first, free flight. The program should pay for your airfare, no ifs, ands, or buts. Usually the program will book the flight and airport of your choice, but sometimes you have to do it yourself. And they're always usually basic seating, but whatever, it's free, right? Pro tip, if you have a preferred airline, tell the representative booking your flight your rewards number. Visit weekends are a great time to rack up those points. There should also be a shuttle or a grad student to pick you up from the airport to the hotel. This can vary from airport and hotel, as some are scheduled for you and some you may need to schedule yourself, but they should still be free to you. Sometimes if you're arriving super late or super early, you may need to pay for an Uber or Lyft to the hotel yourself. However, during these times, these trips should definitely be reimbursed. At some point, either before you leave your flight or soon after you arrive to your hotel, you should get a packet of activities scheduled for the weekend, as well as free swag. You should look at the schedule as soon as possible because your days will be packed. Like seriously, during my visit weekends, my days were packed from 9 a.m. to midnight. And I was doing various things like socializing, lab tours, meeting professors, dinners, and of course partying. However, I know many of you may be introverts and you may need some downtime between events. Do not be afraid to ask for it. The visit weekend is supposed to be informative as well as fun. And the moment it stops being fun, there's no point to it. And with that, we're going to go to the final segment, how to choose an advisor. So at some point during the visit weekend, you'll have 15 to 30 minute individual or group interviews with the advisors you're interested in. And I want to give you some pointers on how to make a successful pick. First, keep an open mind. Don't get fixed on an idea. As you move further into your grad school life and career, you'll find out opportunities are not as narrow or as rigid as you originally thought. Secondly, trust your intuition. Do not try to reason with it. It's telling you something you may not be able to articulate, but you should definitely trust it. A lot of grad students ignore it and are often unhappy with their decision otherwise. Remember, grad school is often 5 years. And number three, choose a person, not a project. I know a lot of people choose labs based on a project that interests them, and while you should work on a project you like and work and in grad school, people don't quit a project, they quit a person. So you definitely want to find someone you like. Number four, you should choose an advisor that you feel that best supports you, emotionally and professionally. You want to pick an advisor who will develop you into the best person of yourself, even if that advisor is not in the field you're originally interested. If you're an amazing scientist in one field, people will definitely believe you can be an amazing scientist in another. Alternatively, you want to choose an advisor you want to be like. You might be smart yet quiet, and if you find a charismatic advisor, they can help you be more charismatic, or vice versa. But I think you should choose an advisor that can fill some of the gaps you have. And lastly, you should have three advisors you want to work with in case things don't work out. Okay. You might be thinking this is great advice, but I'm not really telling you anything, so I want to give you some things you should think about. So you may be wondering if you should choose a young and inexperienced professor or an older established one. And I think there are pros and cons of each one. Let's start with an established professor first. You have a lot of doors to open if you graduate with an advisor with a big name on top of a school with a big name. Also, the lab has an established culture, so the advisor could potentially give you better scaffolding as you develop into a scientist. However, established professors are often traveling a lot, so you may not see your advisor a lot. A younger professor, on the other hand, doesn't have the name nor experience, so there'll be a lot of growing pains as you build a lab and the professor grows with you, so you may need an extra year to graduate while you get things up and running. However, the advantage is you'll be well set up as they have a lot of ideas they're thinking and they want to try out, and they might give you a first author publication on things they actually did. So, for those who don't know, your publications and research are your currency, so you definitely want a lot, like as much as you can. And another advantage of a younger professor is they will have more time for you if you need it. Also, building a lab is well appreciated if you're working in industry, as they are skills most people don't have. Other things you want to consider is if the advisor has money for you if you attend the upcoming school year. Don't imply, actually ask if they have the money for you. If they can't give you a definite answer, keep in mind you might be gambling to get that money. And if they don't have it, you might have to look for a different advisor. In my opinion, you should choose an advisor who has money for you already and one you like. Another thing you want to look for is postdocs. A postdoc is a person who has their PhD already and is working on research to become a professor themselves. They're often knowledgeable about various topics and they can help you if your advisor can't or if they're away. My advice though is you should look for a lab that has at most 50-50 postdocs graduate student. Because if the lab has more postdocs than graduate students, you can probably infer that the advisor doesn't have a lot of investment in the graduate students and they might not be interested in mentoring. You also want to check out the environment of the lab. Socially, I mean, does the lab gel well together? Do they seem like great friends? And most importantly, do you think you can fit in the lab? This question is important because if you don't think you can fit well in the lab and you go into it and you don't fit in, you're gonna have a very hard time. Finally, you should ask the advisor what is the typical 5-year plan they have for students. If they're good, they will ask you on your goals, and if they're not, tell them. And you should see how they try to accommodate you and how they accommodate their style for your research goals. If they don't, you shouldn't go with them. If they try to make them into a mini them, you should not go. You want to find a mentor who is flexible. Also, you should talk to the current and past members of the lab. Advisors can be very charismatic during an interview, and talking to an actual postdoc or current and past grad students will show how the advisor truly is when they're not on their best behavior. And now I'm going to be giving you another list of questions you should ask during the interview. Okay, that's the end of this episode. Next time we're going to talk about how to survive your first year of grad school. This is future PhD, Dr. Ree, signing out. Bye-bye.